So the next talk we're going to do is on return to learn. And so this is a topic I have a lot of passion about. I've learned a lot as a healthcare professional as far as the school system. That's not something that we're taught in medical school, not something we're taught in our residency programs of what exactly happens in the school. Yet obviously you're getting physicians and nurse practitioners and physician assistants who are giving you at the school, if you're in the school districts, recommendations of what you should be doing in school. And so we'll talk a little bit about that as far as what that means and what should we be doing maybe a little bit different. So why do we even care about returning to learn, okay? Well, not all concussions get better in a week. Okay, the majority of concussions are happening from sports, that they're happening in school-age individuals, so that's the huge number, okay? We see less, obviously, because there's less collegiate athletes, there's less professional athletes, so the vast majority of these are going to be happening in school-age, whether it's grade school, middle school, high school. We know that their cognitive function, their ability to think and process information is affected after their concussion, so it's relevant for school. Things in the environment at school, bright lights, noisy hallways, noisy lunchrooms can definitely provoke their symptoms and make them feel worse. And there's oftentimes a lack of communication between healthcare professionals and schools regarding what to do and how do we treat these, which also can lead to other problems. So the focus has always been on return to play. So how do we get these kids back on the field the quickest? Yet remember, they are student athletes. That student part of that word comes first for a reason, okay? Because that's where they primarily are, okay? The vast majority of kids we see are not going to make their living out of their sports, okay? That's a few and far between. And so they're gonna have to make their living off of something that they've developed through their education in school, okay? So many schools and teachers and coaches don't understand the need for assistance for students following a concussion. It's not an outwardly visual diagnosis. So if you're in the school system and you're looking at a kid, you can't tell just by looking at them that they're concussed. And that's one of the things that we emphasize in our offices with these kids is the importance that they communicate with their teachers about how they feel, because their teacher can't see the headache. They can't see that they're having troubles focusing or concentrating. They might be able to tell that they're feeling really dizzy, okay? So if the teacher doesn't know those things, then the teacher can't apply things in school to help them out, or the school can't help them with those things. Again, there's a significant lack of understanding by healthcare professionals of what's the best ways to assist students following a concussion. And many healthcare providers don't understand the school system. It's a completely different language. Like, you know, if I put up a bunch of medical words right now and started talking about all those medical words, most of you get a blank stare and, all right, that sounds good. It's a big word he's using. But in school system, there's a bunch of big words too that are completely foreign to most healthcare professionals, like academic adjustments, academic accommodations, academic modifications. Those things, if I told those and asked those to what are each of those things to the vast majority of physicians or nurse practitioners or physician assistants, I can guarantee you they probably won't be able to answer what's the difference between each of those. Okay? I didn't know those 5 years ago until I started working a lot on this particular topic. So brain rest or cognitive rest, so what exactly is this? Do we put athletes in a dark room and take away everything from them until they're better? Do we put food under the door and say, hey, Johnny, don't come out until you're feeling good? Do we tell them not to go to school until they're symptom free? What about things like screen time, texting, and computers? And so we're gonna address these things because I think these are all important things to talk about and sometimes are common misconceptions and ways that we wanna treat these kids to get them better. So initially we want to restrict the physical activity that increases their heart rate or blood pressure. So that's things like their gym, their recess class, their sporting activities, working out, thinking about their recreational activities that can get them physically active, okay? But those are going to change based on their improvement of symptoms. And there's been a lot of work done out of Buffalo where they actually have shown that actually doing physical activity as athletes start to improve and feel better can actually be helpful with their recovery rather than just keeping them out of all physical exertion until they're completely well. So we do start getting kids a little bit into some activity even if they're still having some symptoms. One of the things I stress with athletes in the office is you know, being in school or doing some physical activity, that's not worsening your concussion. The concussion is the injury that happened when they were on the field or on the court, okay? That was the injury, okay? They're not gonna worsen the injury more by being physically active or doing stuff with their brain in school. They may make their symptoms feel worse, but that's not actually worsening the injury to the brain, okay? And that's a kind of a misconception that we sometimes have when we talk about this injury. And so that's why we do want kids back in school, and that's why we may encourage a little bit of physical activity. Again, early on, it doesn't feel good for most athletes, so we don't want them to do it. And as I talked about, returning or continuing to play immediately after their injury results in prolonged symptoms and worse symptoms and a longer recovery time. But as they get better, and we're still trying to figure out what exactly is that sweet spot for athletes, when can they start doing some physical activity? And hopefully we'll start to have more and more assessments that we can do as finding when that time is, we are gonna let athletes do some physical activity. Again, it may not be full return to their sport at that point, but maybe getting out and doing a little light jog or getting on an exercise bike, doing a little bit of cardio type of activities, okay? And again, there's been research to show that that actually can help improve their symptoms as they get further along from their injury. And then we want to reduce cognitive stress, so reducing their school load or homework. Untimed tests as examples, environmental adjustments. Maybe we have to have them in a quiet area with a buddy at lunchtime. We change where they're seated in class if they're underneath a huge light, okay, or if they're in a heavy, distracting, noisy area of the classroom, move them somewhere else, okay? Same thing like we would do for a kid who has, you know, sensory disorder as an example. So they're hypersensitive and they have to move to a different area of class, okay? Those types of things, simple things like that. We may need to limit things like video games, texting, reading, and computer use. And this is one of the things that a lot of the guidelines have been kind of warped a little bit as far as kind of what's recommended. It's never been that these things are absolutely need to be restricted. And, you know, when I give these talks, and I've given this example a zillion times when I've done these talks here, is what is so mentally stressful about texting? Okay, we tell these kids you cannot text after a concussion. That is the most mindless activity we do as human beings, okay? There's nothing mentally stressful. Their algebra in class, yeah, that's mentally stressful, okay? But texting a message to a friend, come on now, okay? So you have to remember, and this is one of the biggest things, when we're talking about these teenage athletes, they are so socially connected. It's totally different than my generation, okay? Now, my generation's fairly socially connected now too, but it's different, okay? And so if I take that away from a kid, I say, you cannot text, you cannot use your computer, you cannot watch television, you cannot do all this stuff. I've basically punished this kid for getting concussion. They're already punished because they can't do the sport that they love, okay? All those things that I talked about in the research talk initially, okay? They feel crummy, okay? So now I take all that stuff away from them. Do you think that's gonna make them feel any better? Okay, no, it's not, okay? So we do let kids text. We do let kids play video games. Again, I'm not gonna have them do 5,000 texts a day. That's a whole different social situation. That's not their concussion that's the problem, okay? But again, in that big picture of things, when I have these kids in my office and they've been told those things ahead of time, when we tell them to that, oh, it's okay to text, you wouldn't believe the smiles and brightness that comes onto those kids' faces after I tell them, and then look over their parents going, I told you so, mom or dad, I can do it. And so again, we can actually use electronics to our advantage after a concussion. So one of the problems that we see are ocular motor issues where kids have trouble reading across a page or tracking from line to line. So in a regular textbook, I can't change that font, okay? But if I had that same thing in electronic version, I can increase font size on any electronic device I have, okay? So I can actually make it easier for that kid to read using an electronic device, okay? The problem that we see is not necessarily the troubles that they're having using these devices or because it's a screen, it's because of how they're utilizing the screen. So font's too small, that's a problem. If they're using a big bright screen in a very dark room, that's a problem. There's a big contrast there. We see more problems at the extremes of stuff rather than we do at the non-extreme. So if I'm in a well-lit room and I'm looking at a computer screen, my computer screen or my phone screen is nowhere near as bright as what the overhead lights are or the outside light is. Yet we say, oh, well, you can't use the phone because the screen light is too much of a problem for you. It's not, okay? But if I have these kids who are in the middle of the night in their bedrooms and they're getting lit up by their texts from their buddies in the middle of the night, that's a problem because it's distracting their sleep, it's keeping them from getting a good sound sleep, then that is an issue. So I do encourage families, and this again is probably a good thing just in general for general practice, keeping the electronics out of these kids' rooms at night when they're trying to sleep, okay? And just, there was a research study that was done, and this applies to all of us in this room. It wasn't done on concussed individuals, but people who use electronic devices the hour before they're trying to sleep, that directly affects your melatonin levels in your body, and melatonin is a direct thing that helps you initiate sleep. So if your melatonin levels decrease, you don't get as good a sleep, you don't get to sleep as sound, you wake up the next day, you don't feel as good. That's for all of us, okay? So put the electronics devices down about an hour before you want to go to bed, and guess what? You're probably will get a lot better sleep and feel a lot better in general the next day. So we want to consider restrictions on driving, because reduced reaction time is an issue. So at least for that first week after an injury, I'm not having that kid behind the wheel. And I've had lots of examples of kids who have had issues. I had a kid actually 3 weeks ago that just, he had a concussion. From boxing, actually, and he didn't feel good the next day, got in his car, stopped at the gas station, said he was at the gas station and he felt a little bump in his car. He looked around, he didn't think he saw anything, just drove off. 5 hours later, they get a call at his school that he had been in a hit and run accident at the gas station. And he didn't even realize it because he wasn't even aware mentally enough that there was actually somebody around that he actually hit. But they had taken his number, and they corroborated with him and said, yeah, he just drove off slow. He wasn't like speeding away like he knew that he did something wrong. And so he didn't even have the wherewithal to realize that he actually hit someone outside of the fact that he felt a bump in his car. But he looked around and didn't even see anything to him that was a problem. So again, we have to remember these kids are experienced drivers to begin with already. We throw them behind the wheel. They have a lot of other distractions already. That makes them an impaired driver. So certainly, like I said, for that first week, I don't usually encourage kids to be driving themselves. So screens time, like I said, there is absolutely zero research out there that shows that screens are bad. Zero. Okay? It was a guideline put in there of things, these things must be there. I'm assuming it was by someone who just didn't like kids using screens. Okay? We talk about TV as an example, another one. So we've talked about for the American Academy of Pediatrics for years that don't put your kids in front of the TV because it's not mentally stimulating to your brain. Yet we tell them after a concussion, don't watch TV because it's too stimulating to your brain. Well, I didn't realize that TV all of a sudden became much more educational all of a sudden. Maybe if the kids are switching over to PBS or something like that and they're doing that instead of their ESPN or whatever they're watching. Again, that may be the case, but certainly it's not going to be that much more intellectually stimulating to them to watch television. And again, I had already talked about the research as far as electronics before sleep. We do know that disrupted sleep can affect your recovery. And again, just remembering, these kids are highly socially connected. You take them away from that, they're cut off from their friends like there's no tomorrow the next day. I mean, it's ruthless these days with kids and their social networks that they have. So how about cocoon therapy, putting someone in a dark room with little stimulus that's going to get them better? So there's no research to support it, no research to deny it either, but just think about this, okay? How would you feel if someone told you it was your way of getting better after an injury, so you need to stay in a dark room and just be there and stay in that dark room until you came out and felt better? You probably wouldn't feel very good doing that, okay? So it's not going to be great for you, okay? And especially if that person has really mild symptoms, I'm definitely not going to feel very good doing that. And we talk about sensitivity to light as an example of putting kids in dark room if they're really sensitive to light. So if we had all the lights off, if we closed all the windows here so that you can't get any light in here, and we just stayed here for the next 3 hours, we didn't listen to any more talks, we just stayed here in the dark, and I turned on the light all of a sudden or opened up the windows, we'll all be like, oh my God, it's the worst thing ever, okay? So we've made you sensitive to light, okay? So if I take a kid who's already sensitive to light and I put him more in a dark room on a consistent basis, I'm going to make them more sensitive to the light, okay? So having some light is okay, all right? It's the extremes, like I mentioned, that are the biggest problems that they experience. So again, return to learn terminology. These are various things that I kind of alluded to before. So academic adjustments, these are non-formalized adjustments that are made to the student's environment that don't jeopardize their curriculum and do not require alterations to things such as standardized testing. This is the vast majority of what concussed athletes need in the school setting. Okay, are these academic adjustments. These can be applied easily without formal written reports or things like that to do. In fact, actually schools that initiate academic adjustments even before these kids see a physician, that helps, okay? And the school that I work with, or I've worked with extensively at Lafayette in St. Louis, these kids, as soon as they get a notification from the athletic trainer that the person's been diagnosed with a concussion, the email goes out to all the teachers and the teachers start applying stuff even if that kid hasn't seen a doctor yet. Okay? Because we know if you start doing that stuff early on, it reduces the stress and anxiety for these kids, and it helps them, okay? Because depending on how long it takes them to get into a healthcare professional, it may be a few days, and so we don't want to delay that, okay? Academic accommodations, this is where longer-term needs, usually longer than 3 weeks, that may include changes to their schedule, extra time, but within the context still of regular education system, those can be formalized in a 504. We do discourage getting 504s done, at least for the first several months after a concussion. Having been through this individually with my own son, 504s don't happen quickly. And as soon as we request a 504 as a physician, the school is obligated to go through the assessment, which that's a huge drain on schools' resources, okay? So we actually try and discourage healthcare professionals from asking for 504s early on. Now, some schools will do it and have kind of what they call an informal 504, where they just basically put the academic adjustments into a written plan. That's fine, but to go through the full 504 assessment for most kids with concussions, that's gonna be a huge drain on schools' resources, and they're already limited in most schools as it is already. So again, those are not typically going to happen for the vast majority of kids because most kids are going to be fine within 3 to 4 weeks after their injury, okay? And then academic modifications, this is where we have more prolonged and possibly permanent changes, which again is now a very rare thing after a sports-related concussion that would necessitate special education with needs that are made actually now formalized in an IEP and individualized education plan. So those are gonna be really rare for someone after a concussion from sports. So again, given the expected recovery for concussion, 504's IEPs should be used extremely rarely. Even requesting them requires a school to go through the effort. They take time to implement. It's not like, you know, we ask for a 504 and then 3 days later the kid has a 504 formally in place. That takes a while. Again, having gone through the process myself for individual issues with one of my children, they take a while to get put in place. And that's because assessments need to be made by teachers and other individuals in order to get these things happen. And really we try and avoid the concept of homebound. And for multiple reasons. One, I find homebound for most concussions, if schools are initiating that, especially early on, that to me is a school who just wants to, I don't want to deal with this. So go home, okay? That's not the good approach. Because if any of you are familiar with what happens when you're homebound instructed, it's you get one teacher typically that may or may not be specialized in all of your classes that's trying to provide you your education for all of your classes. And so that's not the best environment for that kid as far as how they're gonna do that. And again, it's usually, I find, it's just the schools that don't know how to apply those adjustments that really can be done informally in the school under already things that schools have in place to help these kids. They just need to apply them towards concussions. So for health care providers, really for us, it's understanding and respecting the school terminology and resources, okay? So when we're asking for things that require kids to get back to school, realizing that our recommendations don't have to be followed by the school. So that's some things that, you know, physicians feel, I've written this down, then the school has to do it. Well, technically, no. If I write that the school has to give extra time, tests, and all that stuff, they don't have to do it, okay? There's no legal obligation from that medically. Now, if I restrict them from physical activity, that's a different story. But if I ask for the school accommodations, that doesn't mean that the school has to do them, okay? And if we do make recommendations, the big thing again that I stress with the students and the family is the communication that happens between the student and the teachers as far as how they feel. The more that kids do that, the better they do. And I tell these kids, I realize not every student feels comfortable talking to their teachers. It's like the worst thing in the world. Oh my gosh, I can't talk to my teacher face to face and tell them about my feelings, okay? So I tell them, I understand that, okay? So if you can't talk to them before class or after class, because it's gonna be different potentially from class to class, send an email to your teacher after school and let them know what happened that day in their class. And be specific about it. So don't just tell the teacher, I had a headache today in your class. Tell you, I had a headache because we did this problems today, or these problems, or it was super noisy in class today that really bugged me and made my headache worse, okay? The more specific they can be, that will help and give that teacher information of things that they may be able to do to help adjust for the school setting for that kid to keep them in school. And for us, we need to work with schools. We gotta educate when appropriate. And again, knowing that as healthcare professionals, we weren't taught in medical school or PA school or nurse practitioner school how to manage school days for kids. That's not what we're taught to do, okay? So give a little grace back to the healthcare providers too and educate us, okay? So I've learned a lot from my school colleagues over the last 5 to 6 years tremendously about the school system and how they work and how we can best help these kids for concussions. But that, like I said, I'm an anomaly for a lot of these, and that's what a lot of the people who have worked with me in the schools tell me, I'm an anomaly. But again, we want to make sure that those, so if you're getting notes from physicians or PAs or nurse practitioners and you don't feel that these are appropriate, call them up and just say, hey, you know, this, we can't do this in school. Is there something else we can do to help, okay? For school personnel, encourage communication from the student regarding their symptoms. Ask them, you know. So if they're not going to be forthcoming, bug them about it, okay? And again, just like with the coach, don't accept, I feel fine today, teach. Okay, so don't accept that answer because that's probably not the case or they're not telling you everything. Implementing adjustments for the student even before the note comes from the doctor, that can be very helpful, okay? You know, one of the things that I've been told, my wife is a substitute school nurse and is that schools may not want to do that right off the bat without getting a doctor's note because they're worried that a bunch of athletes are just gonna try and get out of stuff at school. Well, I come back with if it's an athlete, and they're in a concussion protocol, if they're asking for that, well, if they're already getting academic adjustments, it also means they're being held out of their sport. So that athlete probably doesn't have a big, huge kind of ulterior motive as far as trying to get out of a test or a score because they're not gonna be able to play either, okay, if they're in that protocol. Now, if it's a kid who's outside of that, that may be a different story, but most of these athletes are not gonna just try and balk the system and say, I need to get out of a test day because I have a concussion, because they're gonna be automatically out for the next 7 days, most likely, from their sport, okay? So I don't tend to see that as a big problem. If you're seeing that in your schools, that's a different story. Then again, we got to change the culture about that, okay? But again, having these things happen can be helpful for these kids early on. For the athletic trainers, communication with the nurse or counselor regarding the diagnosis and encourage those adjustments to start early. I find that's helpful. For school nurses, using what are called symptom checklists to evaluate these students and let the teachers know what symptoms they're reporting. And for the gym teachers, not having the kids do assignments for substitute for their missed work. So, you know, again, we're trying to reduce their academic workload after a concussion, so we take them out of physical activity, so now the gym teacher said, we gotta write all these reports instead. Come on. Do you really have to do that? And so again, it's one of those things that, yes, I realize that class is important too, but adding more workload to what they're trying to reduce doesn't help these kids, okay? And I've gotten into arguments with PE teachers about that. I'm like, just come on, do you understand what we're trying to do for this kid after a concussion? We're not trying to keep them out of activity just cause, okay? We're doing that because they have to recover, but then we don't need to pile on more work for these kids because it just stresses them out. I've got to write a report about something every day, a new report every day in my gym class, okay? So again, just work with these kids, okay? And then for school professionals, again, remembering the note is not needed to start adjustments. You do not need that from us in order to make adjustments. That's a school dictated problem, okay? And I stress with the kids, my note doesn't make things happen in school. My note just informs the school of what's happening and what's going on and some things that may help. And then formal assessments by counselors, neuropsychologists really aren't necessary early in the process. That may be if we're starting to think about things like 504s down the road. And so what does the research tell us? So we know actually from research that kids are put on strict rest. So they're told to stay home from school, don't do any work, don't do anything. And then we have kids who get back into school after a day or two. The kids who get back to school after a day or two, compared to the kids that stayed home, have less symptoms and they do better quicker and they get back to play quicker than the kids that get home on strict rest for 5 days, okay? So these kids should be back in the school environment, okay? It's healthy for them because one of the things that we see happen when kids are told to stay home and they're told to do nothing is they become what I call sleep zombies. They just sleep the day away. And then once they start to alter their sleep schedules, that has a huge effect on their recovery process, okay? So kids who are allowed to do extremes, so no activity at all, or be completely fully active, both in school and in their sports, they performed the worst at those extremes on these things like impact tests, as an example, compared to the kids that were doing some light physical activity and doing schoolwork back in school just with adjustments. So we know that there's a sweet spot of doing some. So again, it's kind of a moderate approach, not the extremes approach to get these kids better. And we do know that kids that don't make any adjustments at all in school, they just keep plowing through, they do their normal school day, they don't back off at all. Those kids take the longest to get better. If we even back that kid off 20% of their workload, those kids get better just the same as if I eliminate their workload altogether. So again, we don't have to shut everything out, we just need to back off some, okay? So as an example, having the kids do the odd problems instead of all the problems, okay? Those are simple things that can be done to help these kids. But also, if you got the real high achieving student in your class, making sure they're only doing the odd problems. I have a lot of high achieving students that I see in my clinics who their teachers are giving them those adjustments and they're not taking them. They're still doing all the work because they feel like they have to, because that's what they do, okay? And so those are the kids I worry about the most are the super high achieving students because they don't know how to ask for help because they've never had to before. And so they figure, I just can't back off at all and I'm not gonna back off because that'll get me way behind and that's gonna stress them out. So how about, are people prepared? So are educators prepared? So this actually looked at teachers in Alabama. They surveyed them as far as how they feel about concussion. So only a quarter of them felt very or extremely confident to recognize signs of a concussion. Only 15% felt very knowledgeable about concussions. 82% felt they need more information. That's the purpose of events like this, is to help educate, okay? And only 37% said they had taught a concussed student. But 83% reported having strategies to help adjust for those kids. So I guarantee you in the state of Alabama, if only 37% of the teachers there said they've taught a concussed student, they've missed a lot of concussed students. We're talking Alabama, okay? Football, heaven, okay? Besides Texas. So I can guarantee you they've seen the concussed student. They just haven't realized it, okay? How about school nurses? Are they prepared to help with return to learn? So this looked at New England school nurses. So 73% felt that there was inadequate communication with the provider that diagnosed the concussion. So that's a barrier for them. So that's a problem and something that we need to help with. 38% felt were not adequately trained in concussions. 30% felt they didn't have time to care for the student. That to me is a big problem too. If they don't have time to help these kids out in school, when that's part of what they're asked to do as a school nurse, then we need to figure out why that is. And then 20% felt they didn't have the necessary training for the role. And so again, that's where education comes in. How about our schools prepared in general? So this is looking at a national study through the National Association of School Nurses. And 53% of the schools said they had ways to assist students, and there were various things that they talked about. And then 66% of school nurses at a national level felt they had some sort of special training on concussion. So that's good, but there's still a third out there that we could be doing better with. And so why might an athlete not be improving? So, you know, one of the things that happens is after a while, it's like, well, it's still the concussion, it's still the concussion, it's still the concussion, we just give it more time. Most of the kids that I see that have prolonged recovery have one of these issues going on. It just hasn't been sorted out yet by whoever's been seeing them or we're trying to treat. So neck injuries, very common with concussions. So most concussions are whiplash type injuries. So if kids are telling me their headaches are back here and most of my neck hurts, and when my head and my neck, or when my neck hurt, my head hurts, that kid's probably got an associated neck injury with their concussion. Okay, and so we have to treat that, and when we start treating that kid's neck injury and we get very aggressive with that right from the get-go, those kids, their headaches improve quite a bit, okay, because the neck injury can generate headaches. So depression and anxiety, one of the reasons why we talk about not treating concussions like a punishment. Okay, these kids get very depressed and very anxious very quickly, especially when we eliminate a lot of things out of their lifestyle. Okay, vestibular problems, those are issues with the inner ear as far as how your body senses balance or how things are moving around you. Okay, they may have troubles with balance issues, and there's specific rehabilitation we do for athletes who have these that stay prolonged. Visual systems, ocular motor problems, the thing I talked about before, the tracking across the page problem. So there are therapies that can be done for that as well. Okay, sleep problems, again, the kid that becomes a sleep zombie, try and discourage napping throughout the day for these kids. So I want to get them on a normal sleep schedule, normal bedtimes, normal wake-up times, and staying consistent with it. And if they get out of that, that becomes a problem. So I don't mind for the first day or two afterwards of them taking a extra time to sleep, but after that, we really want to get them on a routine because their brain expects that routine, and once we take them out of that routine, they struggle, okay? And then they may be missing meals, and so they're not getting the adequate nutrition and hydration in their body to heal. Okay, so we have to take those things into account. Conversion of an undiagnosed migraine problem. So some kids actually have migraine headaches, they just haven't been diagnosed yet. They've had chronic headaches, they just really haven't been recognized what they were. And we do know that sometimes head injuries can actually make those into a chronic daily migraine problem, and again, addressing that appropriately. And then malingering, which means faking it, that again, I typically don't see very commonly in most of the athletes that we see. Because again, they know that they're gonna get put into the protocol and they're gonna be out of activity for a while. But, because not all athletes get concussed from sports, the kids that are bullied, okay, and I've had several kids who have been in fights in school and have had concussions because of those. Consider the post-traumatic stress disorder type things, the kids who just don't want to keep going back to school, okay, the kids that are trying to stay out of school. You have to ask about these things because that's probably an underlying problem as far as why we're not able to get these kids back to school. They don't want to be back in that environment where they were bullied again. And so those are things that we have to start asking about and thinking about. And the kid that just doesn't seem to be getting better for no reason, they're doing all the right things, so to speak, or they're really trying to avoid being back in the school environment. So those are things we need to talk about. And then legislation, there's been several states that have initiated legislation regarding return to learn. Really, those laws are not necessary. We already have legal protections, okay? So for kids with medical conditions, so that's allowing adjustments to be made. That's through the IDEA Act, which hopefully that still gets recognized with our new Secretary of Education, because she didn't know what those were. And so I worry about that as far as these things being applied for these kids. Also allowing for formal 504s or IEPs, and then further education of school professionals can be helpful. And so some good examples of these, Brain Steps in Pennsylvania, REAP, which is initially initiated in Colorado, although these have actually been applied in other states too. Hopefully maybe someday we can get these things implemented in Missouri too. These are good resources of educating the educators as far as what they need to do to help these kids after concussions. And so those resources are out there. And again, just remembering return to learn, it's an important part of our management program. We want to support these students with their recovery, okay? Encourage student communication about what symptoms they're dealing with. Have fluid adjustments in the school setting. It'll change from day to day how they feel, okay? They may have a good day, they may have a bad day. They may have a bad couple hours at school, and they may have a great couple hours at school. So we just have to be fluid with the adjustments. It doesn't have to be rigid. And again, we just have to keep being educated, just like I talked about with the research talk. This is an ever-changing field. So 3 years from now, we may have a whole different discussion as far as what we're doing. So we just gotta stay on top of this. Okay, that's all I have, so thank you.